Good morning, church. How we doing? I got up here so I could see you guys. Can't see when we're down below. But if you would, could you stand to your feet? Well, we gather today to give thanks to the Lord for who he is and the wonderful works that he has done. Let us thank him together by reading Psalm 105. Can we read this together?
Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord.
Amen. As Christians, we have every reason in the world to be thankful today. Amen? Because God, in his kindness and mercy, has given us his presence to his people. Let us seek the presence of the Lord today, and we are here to worship the King of our hearts. Amen?
Never gonna let me down. laid down, 'cause you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good.
Amen. Amen. Would you say hey to somebody next to you? Maybe you say good morning. Hey, my name is Caleb. Nice to meet you.
I'll just stay down here. Y'all are so crowded up there. I'll just stay down here. Well, once you've greeted everybody in the room, please have a seat. Justin, you didn't get these people over here. Come on, man. Well, good morning. Good morning, everybody. You can have a seat. My name is Doug. I'm one of our elders here at Little Creek, and I am here to welcome you this morning. Hopefully, if you are here for your first, maybe your second time, you may notice this card. It's called a connection card. We would appreciate it if you would fill that out for us. At the end of the service today, there will be an opportunity to come up during the Lord's Supper and place it in one of these two buckets that are next to me. Also, in those buckets, you could put offering. There's envelopes on your chairs or around you, in the chair next to you possibly. But at the end of the service, use those buckets to put your connection card, your offering, your giving, or any prayer requests you might have. That's on the back side of your connection card. There's also an opportunity for Next Steps. Next Steps is just an opportunity for you to serve here at Little Creek. And if you're not sure what areas are in need, please stop by the Next Steps table at the end of today's service and ask the person that's there, say, where can I serve? What can I do? There's all kinds of needs. Kids ministry, stage, sign set up. You can host a small group, which is my next thing. Small groups are meeting in homes during the week, and we have just kicked off a new series, or a session, I guess you call it, in January. So if you have never joined a small group, not even sure what that is, please feel free to ask questions. Come to this Next Steps table. Ask, what does it take to get in a small group? We have 6 groups that meet on different nights of the week. And what we do is we share a meal, we share a Bible study, we share a prayer time, and basically we share in the lives of one another. It's how we stay in community here at Little Creek. So if you are not part of a small group, please ask how to do it, because you will be blessed by it. Who here is in a small group? Raise your hand. You see that? A lot of us. It's a good number. Of the people who are covenant members here, a very high percentage of those are actively involved in a small group. So please get involved. This afternoon, we are having the celebration of life of Michelle and Ron Hartman. That will be at OV Church at 4 o'clock. If you're not familiar with that story or what is going on there, 2 members of Little Creek were vacationing with their daughter Holly this past summer. They were tragically killed in a car accident while in Hawaii. And today is their anniversary, would have been their anniversary. And to honor that, we are having a memorial, a celebration of life service, not a funeral. Let me just remind you, it is not a funeral. This is going to be a celebration of their life. They were believers. They were strong believers. They actively shared their faith. And this is a celebration of their life and the mission that they were on, and allow others to participate and rejoice in it. They are sitting at the feet of their Savior today, praising the Lord. If you knew them, would like to know them, you will learn a little bit more about them if you come today at 4 o'clock. So at OV Church, it's basically a wedding reception type atmosphere, not a funeral, all right? But that is today. That is all I have. I can't think of any other announcements that might be. Covenant membership. So in your small groups, our small group leaders will be walking all of our small group members through what it means to be a covenant member. A covenant member is simply you reading what our church is, what we stand for, what we believe. You read through this document, and at the end of the sheet, you can sign and say, I would like to be a covenant member of Little Creek Church. We do this each year. So on January 1st, our enrollment, our attendance, our membership rolls back to zero. And then by the end of February-ish, we have our new membership for the year. And it's basically you committing to being part of this fellowship. So I encourage you to, those forms will be available. They're not up here yet. Probably on the Next Steps table. But our small groups will be talking about it over the next few weeks to make sure that everybody understands, why do we believe what we believe? What is it that we believe? And what does it mean to be a covenant member? So that'll be happening in your small groups over the next week or two. And then at the end of this month, next Sunday and into February, we will have a time at the end of the service, same time as our Lord's Supper gathering, but we'll have another table up here that is for you to sign the covenant membership and turn that in. So thank you, Kelton. That was a good reminder. All right, I'm going to lead us in prayer. We're going to continue our time of praise and worship this morning, but it's so good to have you here today. A lot of smiles out there. I know there's a lot of sickness. I'm aware of numerous families within our midst that are home battling illness, but Lord, we are just so glad to have you here today. So let's pray together as we continue. Father God, we lift you up now, Lord. We pray that you would just be in our midst, but Lord, that you would dwell in our midst. As your word promises that where two or more are gathered in your name, that you are here with us, Lord, and we feel your presence. We pray that you would just indwell us today as we lift your name up above all others. Lord, we know, as we just sang, you are never going to let us down. You are so good, Lord. You're good to us. And we pray, Lord, that that goodness would just spill through us into other people as we encounter them during our lives. So, Lord, we just pray that you would take over this time, Lord. Make us focus on you. And allow us to worship at your feet today. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. At this time, we want to dismiss the children to Children's Church, where they're going to receive the gospel message in a way that is on their level to understand. And we're excited about the volunteers who are willing and able to go back there every week and volunteer in the kids' ministry area. We have... In some way, shape, or form, we have about 30 people who volunteer in kids ministry, and it is wonderful. We are a growing church that is growing in number and also growing we'll say expecting mothers who are building the kingdom one family at a time. I wasn't planning on making this announcement right now, but my family is one of those. Yes. You're more excited than we were at first. But we are now excited about it. But yes, the Lord has looked upon us favorably, and we so far so good for us. And I know we have at least three other families who are expecting as well in our church. So the Lord's doing a work. Amen? Amen. Would you stand to your feet? We're going to continue to sing.
It is well.
It is well with
Recite the Apostles' Creed together. Yeah? It's going to be on the screen. You don't have to have it memorized, I promise.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Christ Jesus, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, buried, third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Almighty Father. From thence, living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Amen. Can we continue to sing together? Sing that one more time, singing, God, I need you. Thank you.
glorious grace, God, pour out your grace. Glorious grace, that I would be held by your perfect embrace.
We come before you, hearts open, our eyes fixed on you. Lord, forgive us of the spaces that we have hid from you for too long. Lord, let those deep reaches of who we are be exposed to your light. That we would turn to your light, that it would expose the darkness within us. That we might be your people, fixated on the gospel truth that you are God and you are good and you are pursuing us even now. What a glorious grace this is. That we get to cling to you, King Jesus, for who you are and what you did on our behalf. We're able to come to the Father because of the work of the Son by the power of the Holy Spirit. And this triune God is whom we place our trust in. So Lord, let this gospel message ring true now as we read your word. Let our hearts be exposed of our sin, that we could repent of it. Let us be a people who are continuously on your mission, not just when it's convenient, not just when we think about it, but all the time beyond your mission that you've called us to in our walks of life. Lord, be with us now. It's in your beautiful name I pray. Amen. Amen. Would you be seated? So I want to acknowledge, before we get started, Dylan, if you don't mind, can I share? Okay. Dylan lost his mom this week, lost her to a long bout with cancer, and I'll let him speak to the details of it all, but one of the things that I know that his family is rejoicing in is that she's no longer suffering here, and she's in glory. She is a wholehearted believer. They had a straight-up worship service yesterday in Pittsburgh. He said over like 400 people came. People got saved at her funeral. Like, that's what I long for in my celebration service, if you will, is that people would see the gospel and turn to it because of the legacy of faith that I have left. And so we are grateful to you, Dylan, and anything we can do to serve you guys, we would love to do that. And then he was going to come up. He was going to preach this week, and he's like, so, like, I don't remember. It was like maybe Wednesday or Thursday. So I don't know that I'm going to. I was like, Dylan, are you crazy? You're not preaching. Like, your mom died this week. He's like, okay. And then he calls me yesterday, and he's like, hey, so we're on our way home. And, you know, I'd really like to help lead worship with you and Leilana. And I said, cool, man, no problem. And then I get a text this morning, hey, Taylor's, like, not feeling well at all, and I'm not going to be able to do that. It's like, cool, man, just be you. So maybe stay away from Dylan. Say hey to him from a distance. Now, they've done a lot of traveling in the last couple of weeks, and we just want to say thank you for your serving here and your willingness, not only willingness, but your desire to be here with the people of God. Thank you for that. What an example of what it means to shepherd people. Love you, brother. Really do. And just grateful that that you are doing this with us and that we get to do this thing together and continue to see the gospel move forward here in the Tidewater area. One other news of note, there is an organization that we are a part of called the Southern Baptist Conservatives of Virginia, or the SBCV, okay? And they are coming down here at the beginning of February to basically highlight Norfolk as an area to plant churches in. And they asked us to essentially be the host for those days. They asked us as Multiply. And so I don't think Dylan knows this yet, but he's going to be driving this is how interwoven we are. OV has a bus, like a 25-person, like, short bus. And Dylan's going to drive it. Dylan doesn't know that yet, but Dylan's going to drive it. And as a upcoming church planter in the area, he's going to drive it, and I am going to be the tour guide of Norfolk. I'm pretty sure I missed my calling. I think that's what I'm supposed to do for the rest of my life, is be a tour guide. So I'm going to go do that to the glory of the Lord, and I'm going to show them all the places that we need churches and all the places that we have gospel-centered churches already. And the people who are coming are from, like, Roanoke, from Fredericksburg, from all areas of the state, because they want to know where can they send people to plant churches. We're going to be like, Norfolk, send them here. We got an organization here right now that is planting churches, and you can come be a part of it. And so we get to do that. We're excited about that. So that is going to be February, I believe it's 6th and 7th. So be praying for us as we do that. That is a fun time to just expose the deep gospel need here in our city. For 20 to 30 years now, the ongoing phrase is Norfolk is the place that church plants go to die. I don't know about you, but we're not dead. And we planted in Norfolk, so we're here to tell them, no, it's not. Come be part of it with us. Come do it as well. And Dylan is going to get to have his story on display for these people to come and maybe help him, maybe bring some people to help him plant as well as we send our own people out to help him plant. So it's going to be good. All right, y'all ready to get into Luke? All right, turn, if you would, to page 971. Luke 10. Luke chapter 10. In my Bible, it is 971. We're going to be at the end of Luke 10 today. For what we've been doing, this is a fairly short passage. We've been walking through Luke now, I think since the fall, beginning of the fall, in September, and just kind of walking line by line. We took a break. We didn't even take a break. We skipped over the Christmas narrative, and then we went back to it during Christmas. And so now we have done all, we've gotten through all of Luke. We are caught up to date in Luke 10. And last week we talked about Jesus sending out his followers and supplying them with all of their needs. Today, we find another familiar passage. This is the Good Samaritan and Mary and Martha. The Good Samaritan and Mary and Martha. We're gonna dive into our time as people today, our time, and how it can glorify God in the everyday of life, because ultimately how we spend our time will determine how we share Christ's love to others. So would you pray with me as we get into the Word? Heavenly Father, be with us now as we read your Word, that it would expose what it needs to expose, that it would show grace to where we need grace. And pray, God, that we would be fixed on you right now, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going to read Luke 10, 25 to 29. All right? 25 to 29. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, "Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" He said to him, "What is written in the law? How do you read it?" By the way, can I just stop right there? Sorry, you can leave it on the screen. Can I just stop right there? I heard it said this week that in the dominant kind of the culture in Israel was that they often would answer a question with another question. People wonder, why do they do that? And I would say to you, why not? Good stuff. Let's keep going. And he answered. This is the lawyer answered Jesus, saying, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself." And he said to him, "You've answered correctly. Do this, and you will live." But he, the lawyer, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, "And who's my neighbor?" So in those days, back in those days, a lawyer in Israel was a professional academic expert. Okay, they were not necessarily practitioners of the law. They were academic experts of the law, right? So they knew the law very, very well, but they were not necessarily in the courtroom like our lawyers are today, judging criminal and civil cases. They are not judging, you know what I mean, hearing. What, you know, you get it. You've seen enough Law and Order shows to know what our lawyers do. But in those days, lawyers were really academic, just smart people, learned people, if you will. They were experts. So, in other words, this lawyer, he wasn't asking Jesus questions because he didn't know the answer. He was trying to trip Jesus up with his answers. Okay? So we need to hear, that's a totally different tone than a, what do I need to do to inherit eternal life? That's a different way of asking the question. That's a different way of reading the passage. And so he says, what do I need to do, teacher? Yeah, you tell me. I know the answer. You guys ever do this to your kids? Like, why did we hit? We know the answer because they're crummy little sinners. That's why they hit. Right? That's kind of what this lawyer is doing. And then we see this man's arrogance in verse 29 because he tries to justify himself. Jesus says, go do this and you will live. And he's like, well, who's my neighbor? In other words, do I really have to talk to everyone? Is it really everyone that I'm around? Everyone, really? Not just the people that I'm comfortable with? Do you ever try to justify yourself when you're wrong? Leilana, bless her heart, she's never been wrong in her life. Did you know that? She will always justify why she's not wrong. And her mom, well, she's actually never been wrong. Right? Right, Jayla? Happy wife, happy life. I don't know where Leilana got it from, but they literally have never been wrong. Like, it's just always a reason why they're not wrong. And it's like, it's like you have the candy bar in your hand, and you're going, I wasn't going to eat it, right? Like, just never wrong, never wrong. Well, knowing this about the lawyer, Jesus tells the story. Let's pick it up in verse 30. Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was walking down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay when I come back. Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. So we can discern a lot of possible reasons that the priest passed by the man. But honestly, busyness and doing other good things for the Lord were likely the reasons why they passed him by. It's not because they were bad people. Let's not say, oh, all priests are bad. Please don't say that. Like, not all pastors are not bad. All people doing the Lord's work are not bad because they passed by this one guy. They were most likely busy. They had somewhere else they needed to go. Something else they needed to do, right? That's never happened to us before, right? Sometimes we get caught up in our work and our own priorities, and we're set out in this way of doing things, and we're like, well, I got a 9:30 I gotta get to. I got a 10 a.m. I gotta make it to. And so I want to tell you a quick story. In the 1970s, some students from the Princeton Theological Seminary, they participated in a study about pro-social behavior, which basically is doing good things for other people. Okay, so that's what they were doing, and they were they were asked to come to a warehouse, and in this warehouse, they were going to sign some documents about being a part of the study, okay? And some of the people were told, you better get here right now, or else you're going to be late. Some people were told, hey, you're already late, you need to get here, because we need to get these papers signed. And some people were told, hey, you got plenty of time, come here when you can. No time limit, okay? And so they're all set up to sign these papers in this warehouse. And then the people doing the study actually set up a scenario where they had to go by somebody who was in need just to see what they would do. And they found out that 65% of the people who had nothing but time helped them. Okay, and they also found out that I think it was around 30-some percent of the people who were on time helped, and then 10% of the people who were late did not help. What does that tell you? They were busy. Overwhelmingly, the amount of time that these students had to get to their appointment determined if they would help the person in distress. And the point is this: when people are busy or rushed, they are drastically less likely to help others in need. Even if they're religious people, even if they're people who are saved by grace, if they are late, they will not help others. This, again, we're always talking about other people. We're never talking about ourselves in these messages, right? It's never about what you go through. It's always someone else. Building margin in our schedules is a spiritual issue. Building margin in our schedule is a spiritual issue. What's margin? Let me tell you what margin is, okay? Margin is the gap between what we're currently maintaining in our schedule and what we are absolutely capable of maintaining in it. That is the margin. So basically, what are we doing now and what are we capable of doing is margin, okay? Does that make sense? Yes, no, this is yes, this is no, all right, we got it? Okay. I love you enough to tell you this, that most of us are operating all the time with essentially zero margin, which leads us to a lack of love for Christ and love for others. Because we take everything right to the edge of our time. Most of us are that way. If you're like, not me, well, good for you. I guess you can tune it out. But the rest of us who are always right on time for work, a little bit late for church, right on time for our appointments, maybe a little late to our appointments. All right, I'm gonna do this. Raise your hand if that speaks to you at all. My wife better have her hand up. And I'm not wrong about that. Yeah. Many of us have filled our lives completely full, and therefore we have no extra time for anything unexpected. Like helping someone in need, or having enough time to have a gospel conversation with somebody. Heaven forbid somebody comes up to you and says, hey, I see that you're wearing a church shirt. I see that you have a sticker on your car. I see something about you, or maybe it's somebody at work. They're like, hey, I know you're a Christian, right? Can you tell me about Jesus? And heaven forbid you stacked yourself, well, I get off work at 3, so at 3:05 I got this happening. Don't build any margin. There's no space for stuff outside of the norm. And therefore, there's no space for us to be Christ to others. You tracking? This hit me this week. Just so you know, I do this every time, but I'm always preaching to myself when I preach to you, because this is a real thing that I think our culture does not allow for. They do not allow. We need a schedule that is regimented, and if you have too much time in your day, you're lazy. That's what America tells us, right? But it's interesting because we all know it's important to save money for times when unexpected things happen. And also to save money for the ease of mind and financial stability. But not many of us ever think to save time in pursuit of the same thing. Right? We save money, but we don't save time. We got to wring out time as much as possible. Because of this, we find ourselves pinched. We become unable to study and meditate on the word. We have no time to spend doing good, soul-filling time in prayer and to live as ambassadors of Jesus. And this really leads us to a few questions we need to consider today. First question is this: what current priorities do I have that regularly squeeze my focus time with Jesus in the word and prayer? I know it's a long question, but what current priorities do I have that regularly squeeze my focus time with Jesus? And essentially, what doesn't allow me to spend time with Jesus? What is it in my space of work of schedule that doesn't allow me to spend time with Jesus? This is really a question of priority. We need to reprioritize our time demands and make time with Jesus the main thing that never gets pinched out. Amen? If it's a priority issue, if getting to work on time is here, family time is here, date night's here, friends are here, time with God is whenever I can fit it in, you'll never fit it in. Unless you make him a priority, you will never, ever do it. We need to reprioritize and make sure we put first things first and have Jesus in that slot that never gets compromised. Some of you are looking at me like, yeah, sure, I know. Then do it. And if you're like, I already do it, fantastic. Teach someone else how to do it. This is, again, I jokingly said you can tune out. You actually can't, because you got to figure out how can you take this and share it with somebody else. Because that's what we do in the community of faith. We don't just keep things for ourselves and become this sponge that is soaked all the time and just stays saturated. We need to be the sponge that gets saturated and wrung out to other people so that we can then get saturated again to then wring out more. Amen? Leads us to our second question. This is the more fun question. What things in my schedule is God calling me to cut back or let go of in order that I might have time to prioritize him and his mission? Ah, dang it, he said it. Now I gotta let go of something. Really, this is a question of elimination or reduction, okay? And these could be good things, neutral things, or just bad things. Okay, I'm going to give you some examples to help you. So some good things that we might need to cut back on are our kids having lots of opportunities for good things. Like, I'm talking, you know, softball on this day, gymnastics on this day, time with friends on this day, and dance on this day. All, you know, and we have 8 things a week and only 7 days to do them in. Right? Some of us parents do that for our kids. Another good thing that might need to be cut back on is serving in church, because it's a good thing, but it can begin to compromise our time with God. Some neutral things: time on social media, time on your phone, time watching TV. These are morally neutral things, but they need to be cut back on or let go of if they're keeping you from giving Jesus time in worship and serving. And some bad things that probably need to stop or just time spent drinking too much and having a crappy day afterwards, or maybe smoking weed, or binging on TV into the wee hours of the night, and indulging in your addictions or your hang-ups. These are obviously bad things, and they take time away, and really, it's time for us to get serious about cutting these things out of our lives in order to have true fruitfulness and joy in Jesus. Whatever it might be, there are things that we are called to remove from our life in order to walk faithfully in the Spirit. And y'all, there's some practical examples here, some simple ones. I don't know how your life works, but I know how my life works. And probably one of the things that I could get cut back on is I could go to bed earlier. Because if I go to bed earlier, that means I could get up earlier. I don't need more sleep. I just need sleep at different times, right? I am the girl's got to be at school at 8:30. Bet I'll be up at 7:45, right? Slamming clothes on them. Come on, we got to go. And that's because I went to bed at, midnight, 1 o'clock, and I'm tired. But what if I went to bed at 10 or 11 and then got up at like 6? Same amount of time, right? But then I've got all that time to be in the Word before the kids even get up. Hallelujah. It's, I don't know what it is for you. That's what it is for me. Think of a time for yourself. Where do I need, I need to spend time with the Lord? It might be you have an hour lunch break and you spend every bit of that hour watching Netflix on your phone. And so, like, maybe it's not a morning and night thing for you. Maybe it's a completely during the day thing. Maybe you put Netflix away and you get the Bible out and you read it and you spend time with the Lord. You spend time in prayer with Him to carry you through the rest of your day. I don't know what it is, but God is calling us to give up something in order to replace it with Him. Amen? A lot less amens on that one. I understand. It can hurt your feelings. But I want to look at John 15 for a second. John 15, 1 through 11 says this. I am the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, He prunes, that it may bear more fruit. Already, you are clean because of the word I've spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I'm the vine, you're the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he's thrown away like a branch and withers. The branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, my words abide in you. Ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I've spoken to you, that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full. We cannot expect to live faithfully for the Lord if we don't first abide. In order to abide faithfully in him, we will need to prune ourselves, set priorities, right? And let's be careful not to twist the purpose of our abiding. This is not a religious or legalistic thing, okay? We don't do this to prove ourselves to be good or to make sure that God favors us more. Abiding is a godly discipline needed to walk in life and blessings that God has already given us in Christ in love. It is not to earn his favor, because we can't. It is not possible to earn his favor. All we can do is abide in his love. This is the godly discipline of following the Father's commandments like Jesus did, because we know that as we do this, we walk and abide in the love that is already given to us in Christ. We need to create margin in our schedule in order to abide. We need to create margin in our schedules to abide. All this time that we are reprioritizing to spend with the Lord, it inevitably will result in helping our neighbor in need, because out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks and the actions happen because of where our heart is, right? So if our heart is abiding, then our efforts will be in his name and not in our own. Let's keep reading. Going to Martha and Mary, 38. Now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and the woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teaching. But Martha was distracted with much serving. She went up to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Tell her then to help me out." But the Lord answered, "Martha, Martha, you're anxious and troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her." So Jesus visits Mary and Martha. Mary sits at his feet to listen, and Martha is busy with the chores of the household. This is a real life circumstance. People say the Bible isn't practical. Come on now. You ain't reading. All the mamas just laughed a little bit. On a daily basis, I hear Leilana and Audrey argue about whose day it is to do the dishes. Every day. I did it yesterday. It's your turn. Well, you got to do the dogs then. Because that's the back and forth that they get, right? In the amount of time that they argued about it, they could have gotten the dishes done, right? So this is the squabble that Mary and Martha are in. They're arguing about who's going to do the dishes. Who's going to do the household chores? And if you think less of me because my kids do the dishes, come talk to me about it. Because they're doing some good stuff. Our kids are responsible and, yep. Martha's like, "Jesus, don't you care that she won't help?" I almost hear that in her, like the uptick in her voice. Like, "Jesus, Mary's not helping." Right? I want you to know that you've probably met a Martha before. Let me paint the picture. Martha is happy to serve, yet somehow her serving makes her sour. She might be a little bossy, maybe. She says, "Tell her to give me a hand." She's a little impatient with people who she thinks aren't serving or helping enough. Folks, churches are full of Marthas. Yeah, not our church. Again, we're talking about somebody else's. But churches are full of Marthas. So like they look around like, "I'm doing all this work. So-and-so ain't been here in months." We got a lot of Marthas out there. This can also be found within the home, though. In the person, we're not going to say it's a female. Martha's a female, but the person in the home who is doing the bulk of the work, they start to feel like no one cares if they're serving. No one sees their work. No one sees the dishes getting done, the meals being prepped, the breakfast being served, the backpacks being expected for the day, the shoes on the kids' feet for school.
the dinner on the table, the homework checked, the hustling to and from work with no time to spare, the constant feeling that you aren't keeping up with it all. This overwhelmed and anxious feeling that many people in America face is exhausting. It's exhausting. And Martha thinks that the answer is more help. But Jesus gives her the answer. The busyness of serving the family can seem exhausting when we don't first put down the towel and sit with Jesus. Jesus says, in your busyness, don't forget that one thing is necessary. And that one thing is not the next task on the checklist. That one thing is not to serve more people. That one thing is to enjoy Jesus for himself. Enjoy him. How? By building margin in your day for the Lord, no matter what's going on. So a question for you to ponder today is, would you make spending time with Jesus a priority? Would you consider making spending time with Jesus a priority? Then as you do that, watch your attitude towards serving others change for the better. Bitterness will leave and be replaced by joy. Because your joy isn't found in a person's response to your service. It is found in the Lord. Now, the other person in the home, again, I'm being gender neutral here. In my home, I'm talking to myself for a second to say this. It is imperative for you, because it's one of the best ways that you can love your wife or your spouse, is to make sure that they have time with the Lord. Husband, make sure your wife has time with the Lord. Take the kids. Go do something else with them. Take on more responsibilities at home. Do the dishes. Sweep the floor. Put the clothes away. Do something so that she can spend time with the Lord, or so that he can spend time with the Lord. It is the way that we can steward our spouse's relationship with God. This hit me like a ton of bricks, because Jayla is flipping superwoman, and she does everything really, really, really well with full excellence. And I can tend to take that for granted. I'm telling you, in front of God and everybody, that I am guilty of taking her for granted, in the sense that she does a lot of things really well, really fast. I do a lot of things mediocre and really slow. But I am willing to take that on out of conviction, because she needs more time with the Lord. And folks, not more time on the phone, not more time watching movies, more time with the Lord. Not more time for self-help. More time with the Lord. So I'm sorry, babe. I'll be better. We all need to do whatever we can to take more time to sit at the Lord's feet. To sit at the Lord's feet. And this is where we finish today. Many of us don't have enough margin in our schedule. How can we reconcile that today? How can we start that today? Remember, this isn't couch time to build the margin for. This isn't time for more house projects. This isn't time for more you time or girl time or guys' night. This is time for you with the Lord. I'm not talking about 4, 5, 6 hours just in your prayer closet by yourself. That's probably, for some of you, irresponsible. But whatever time you're giving, you could give more to him. Doesn't he deserve it? There are some things that we can carve out practically and easily. I'll give you a few. You could leave for your appointment 15 minutes early. And when you do, watch your eyes open up to things around you. When you're not rushing to get there. Give yourself 10 minutes in the car before work just to pray for your day before you go. 10 minutes. I mean, that's really all it might take for some of you. Why do we do this? Because we can't forget our first love. So often we let our service and our busyness of life take over our hearts, and we leave no room for the gospel to take root. We forget that Jesus came to live the life that we couldn't and die the death that we deserve on the cross. And this is where we ought to meditate, because Jesus said, "I am enough." The question for you is, would you lay down your burdens and pick up the hope of salvation that he offers to us freely? Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I ask that you would forgive us. That you would forgive us for making other things a priority and not you. I ask that you would forgive us for not giving you the time that you deserve, not building in the margin that you've asked us to, that you've called us to. And Lord, I pray that we would walk right now in faithful obedience to you. Thank you, Jesus, for the conviction of sin, the conviction of our behavior, that we might turn towards you. I pray that our hearts and our minds would be turned to you now. It's for your beautiful name. Amen. Amen. As we respond in worship, we're going to take the elements back to our seat. This is our act of worship, where you could take the cup and you take the cracker, and you are reminded of Jesus' body broken, his blood shed. We take these elements every week. This is the Lord's Supper. We take them and we are reminded of what Jesus did for us. It was my sin that held him there, right? And as we do that, we also have the buckets up here where you can fill out a connection card and turn that in. You can also give if you give in these buckets. This is our time to respond in worship. So would you stand and respond now?
You have been faithful.
so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In the darkest nights, you were close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. The goodness of God.
Church, don't forget of the celebration of life. Everyone is invited. If you didn't know Ron and Michelle, that's cool. You can go there anyways and celebrate them. You know Holly. She's right there. She's their daughter, and she would love to have you there. It is going to be a celebration of life service and then a reception afterwards. And if you want to bring, you know, an old Baptist covered dish, more than welcome to. I'd love to have it. And if not, just come as you are and enjoy the catered Pollard's chicken. Oh, amen. Amen. Yeah. Yeah. No. No. All right. Well, church, have a great week. We will see you hopefully this afternoon. If not, then we will see you next week. Little Creek Church, you're scattered.